Vittorio, it's a pleasure to have you with us at the 20th Nova Conference. Thank you for being here. As you know, the focus of this edition is the role that responsible leaders have on broader society in moments of unprecedented change. Given your experience, we feel especially privileged to have you here. In the intro, my colleague provided just a glimpse on your career, but there is so much more to say. We would like to start our conversation from the key turning points in your career, from your MBA at Harvard Business School in 1990 to your role leading the Italian COVID Task Force in 2020. Would you mind giving us your perspective?
No, first of all, thanks a lot. It's a pleasure to be with you today, even if, of course, it's only via video. I'm not sure I want to talk about the turning points. You know, each of us have a turning point, which sometimes it's personal, sometimes it's professional. I would talk a little bit about, I would say my career almost like in the three phases, the phase of learning, the phase of doing, and then the phase of contributing, which is where I'm now. Because I think it's an interesting way of looking at things, which is not career steps, but more, you know, what has shaped the phase. The first phase was the phase of learning. You mentioned Harvard Business School. I would put in this phase three things. I would put in this phase the military, believe it or not, where I really, I think I got this concept of leading from the front and being always with the troops, with the people that work with you, and never kind of being a distant leader. Then Harvard Business School, as you mentioned correctly, HBS and MBA in general was, if you want, the joy of assessing problems and situations together with others, and the power of the team, of a bright, intelligent, smart team. And then McKinsey, which was, quite frankly, the period of data, facts, analysis. And you put the three together, it gives already a little bit my concept of what is a leadership model. A leadership model is about having facts, having the analytics, but also leveraging other people and having, you know, the power of collective brain together, and then leading from the front and giving the example. And that was first phase, more or less, finishing in the mid-90s. Then I had the kind of the era of doing. And again, three experiences here. The startup of what today is Vodafone Italy, that used to be Omnitel. And here, I would say the exciting thing was entrepreneurialism and doing and making things happen. Also, I was very young. You know, you're in the mid-30s. You are in the moment where you have the maximum energy. And making things happen, creating something that didn't exist before, was very important for me. Then I left for a couple of years. I ran a media company there. It was more the power of shaping everybody else's information base and opinion, and how you can really contribute to the formation of social and political consensus. And then the amazing adventure of Vodafone Group, where I had, you know, to put together the group, rationalize, create the culture, the pleasure of multiculturalism, and really the love for the world. It's the phase where I really love the world. And so this was more a phase of doing and the phase of taking responsibility and feeling on you the weight of responsibility. But I also have to say, feeling the joy of seeing things happen, something that didn't exist before and suddenly exists, or a culture, a way of working that suddenly becomes the norm because you have got impact. And now the third phase is the current one, where there is more kind of a variety of experiences and trying to help others in a way have the same joys and same responsibilities they have got. And here, what I'm finding out is that you can do it in a variety of ways. So I'm on the board of Unilever, which is a fantastic company. And again, you know, they're helping as a board management team to succeed and to make their strategy succeed and also do well to the world, or Verizon, which is the same thing. But also, I'm working with General Atlantic, which is growth capital, and again, helping young or younger entrepreneurs making their dream happen and providing at the same time wisdom and sometimes also warning, because sometimes, you know, there are also mistakes that can be made in order to allow others to follow the same thing, which is a little bit, I think, the real peak of leadership, which is when you accept that others will have the responsibility, but you really want to help them and steer. And in this context, I had also the Italian task force kind of assignment, where I got a call one day from the prime minister. I was walking in the garden in front of my house during the lockdown. And he said, "Hey, Mr. Colau, I don't know you, but they say good things about you. Will you come and help?" And it's one of those things that you decide in 2 hours and you say, you know what? It's a bit of duty, a bit the kind of pleasure of being called, but also the kind of challenge of doing something which is completely undefined, because what does it mean to be the chairman of a task force in the middle of a crisis? And again, it's the pleasure to contribute, in this case, to your country and to hopefully, you know, the solution to this problem with your experience, with your energy, with your passion, and so on. So I would say learning, doing, contributing have been the big three chapters of my life.
Thank you very much, Vittorio. And your answer leads us to our second question. What does responsible leadership mean to you? Has your view changed over time?
It's a very good question, because there's a lot of discussion about you know, responsible leaders and the position of the U.S. Business Roundtable, American capitalism versus European capitalism, and in general, what should the leader really do? If I'm honest, you know, my view has never changed. So I have to say honestly, I never changed. I thought what I thought before, and I still keep thinking the same. And it's a balanced view. So I thought that certain, you know, excesses that were defining the role of leadership very narrow, like, you know, you're a leader, you have to maximize shareholder return, and that's what you have to do, was too narrow. I always thought that your role is to make sure that whatever organization you work in, whether it's for profit or for non-profit, it doesn't really change too much. It's really to do what is right for the long term of your customers, or the people who, you know, you interact with, your employees, the people around you, the citizens, and your suppliers. In the end, you know, if you have the four communities around you see the value of what you do, in the long term, you know, you're leading well. And you know, you can also make the point that for a business, which is probably what interests most of the people who listen to this video, a successful business is also very important, because if you are not successful financially, you cannot invest. If you're not successful financially, you cannot innovate. If you're not successful financially, you will end up having to fire people. If you're not successful financially, you don't pay taxes, which, by the way, will be very important in the future. So I am a little bit skeptical when I hear people to say, oh, capitalism. I used to hear people say, oh, capitalism and leadership is about maximizing one dimension. And I'm also skeptical today when I hear, oh, forget completely. This has completely changed. The reality is that at the end of the day, you know, a leader needs is a person who thinks about what is good and right for the long term, and applies not just ethics. I know you guys in business schools now study a lot ethics. I'm a bit critical sometimes of that ethical thing, because it's very easy to write on a wall five principles and then be a complete bad person or bad company. I think there must be also morality a little bit. So it's not just ethics. Ethics is about what is legal, what is permitted, and what is tolerable in a society. I think you also have to go to the moral side of things, what is right, what is really desirable for the human beings that are connected. And if you follow that thing of saying, you know, do what is right for the long term, don't take short-termism as an excuse, you know, most of the times, if you have skills, which of course you guys are now learning, you do the right thing and you are a responsible leader.
And as CEO of Vodafone and RHS, operating in the essential and sensitive telco and media sectors, how did you balance the interests of your company with that of broader society?
Listen, it's a good question, because it follows the previous point. And if you're listening to this video, you might be thinking, oh, okay, Vittorio has given the classic good response. You know, think about the long term, be good to humans, and it's easy. And the reality is that the problem emerges when you have a practical decision to make. And I think, I mean, if I look at my kind of, you know, whether it was an important decision or a stupid decision, plenty of times you have things which are, you know, in media, for example. I was publisher. I was a publisher. Is it right to publish gossip magazines? At what level gossip becomes corrosive of the society? In telecommunications, what do you do with legal interception and privacy and security? How do you balance the need to protect the society from terrorism, but also the need to protect the citizens from a dictator or a bad government that want to use technology to enforce a bad regime? Is it right to move your operations to, for example, Ireland to reduce VAT, which at some point I had to look at, because in Vodafone we could have done a certain setup in Ireland for our prepaid business that would have saved VAT. At what level you push products or services, I don't know, in Africa or in India, which have zero market, but they are very good for women or very good for, you know, people who have low literacy and can help. So is it good for shareholders? It's not good for shareholders because you lose money, but it's good for the society where you work. So, and I always thought that at the end of the day, there's like the way you solve these things is always two things. One, what would the customers think about your decision? Think about your customers. Would my customers kind of like the idea that, again, in my example, I don't cooperate with the authorities to protect the society from terrorism? And would they like the idea that I do it in such a way that also tries to protect a bit their privacy? On how much? And what's the balance? And the same thing for, you know, the, you know, tax matters, you know. Is it right to pretend that you operate out of a country when you're not? And what would customers think? And so in the end, it's something that I always goes back to, how would you feel about your decision and the thinking behind your decision, not just the decision, is exposed to public scrutiny from the people you care most about, which are your customers, your employees. And if you follow this thing and you allow in the company a lot of discussion with all the angles being debated, and you don't stop the discussion, and you have, you know, dissident voices saying, hey, I don't think this is right, or hey, I think this, I remember when mobile phones came and pictures were coming, it was very easy to see a wonderful business in exchanging, you know, funny pictures, but we didn't have the tools of today. So immediately, you know, it went into pornographic stuff and we stopped it. So we said, we don't have the tools to stop it. Now, today it's possible, but, you know, in the early, phase of 3G, it was not possible. So we decided not to open the business. Others decided to open the business. We decided not to do it. And we realized that we had to police the system to make sure it wouldn't happen. So debate internally, listen to many business voices, but also non-business voices. Talk to other corners of the society to really understand the implication of what you're doing. And eventually, you know, go back to, you know, your morality and not just the ethics. And I have to say, I'm not sure I got everything right, but most of the times when we took decisions which were unclear or borderline, I found that the support from the people, from the customers, from those who really understand why you have done it and you explain it, has been fantastic.
Thank you. You briefly touched on your role in the COVID task force, and our next question is exactly on this topic. The COVID task force was comprised of exceptional people working in exceptional circumstances. They had very different backgrounds, worked remotely, and were under extreme scrutiny and pressure, all this while being in close connection with the government. What did this experience teach you from a leadership point of view?
So it's I never really made comments about that period publicly. So this is the first time, and I hope this will be taken in the right way. I think it has been incredible because you had, first we were 15, then we became 20. 20 people who have never met before with the exception of one. So I knew one person before. The others were unknown faces to me, and I was, you know, unknown to them. Very, very different backgrounds. So you go from people who are consultants. So I could imagine that the, you know, head of BCG was, would have been very similar to me, or bankers or lawyers, but others were professors of psychology, professors of psychiatry, sociologists, expert of the environment. There was professors of any kind. So literally every domain represented, very different, with very different way of working and also thinking, which is that's the thing we are less used to in business. We tend to have, we call diversity what is not really diversity. It's a little bit of difference in background, but not much. And here, this was really different. And to be honest, it has worked well, because I don't want to say good things about myself, but I really allowed everybody to kind of go in the direction that they thought they were good at. Not completely, identifying, you know, sub-leaders for the different groups, but I didn't pretend to control myself, for example, the more social elements of our recommendations, because I said, listen, guys, I'm not a social expert. I know nothing about certain things, but, you know, I'm more on industrial policy. I'm more on how to control the medical aspects. We said there's a scientific committee. We will never even question a word of that. However, the implication on unlocking the country and reopening the country, that will be ours. And so if you want, the lesson is that if you have a little bit of orchestration, you need to have some orchestration, because otherwise, you know, 20 people never will never work together. And you communicate how important it is to have a product for each deadline. And we had very, very tight deadlines, as you can imagine. I mean, I remember the first, the committee was officially appointed by decree on a Friday. On Saturday, the prime minister called this first video conference. And he said, okay, I want to have the criteria on how to unlock all the industrial sectors and service sectors in Italy, and what kind of safeguards, this is and that. And then I said, okay, 3 weeks. And the guy goes, no, 7 days. You have 7 days to do it. And eventually we did it in 10 or 11. But, you know, when you're in that situation, allowing people to say, okay, you go on what you're really very good. And you have to be sure that somebody will make mistakes. But at the end of the day, the advantage of what they really bring in terms of pluses will be so big that they will realize themselves what is not really relevant. And eventually, over time, they will accept the opinion of the others in terms of converging towards one solution. And so what I learned is good people have to be unleashed, and even if they're very different, and you have to force them to take back, the things that don't work from a team perspective. Rather than trying to orchestrate everything yourself, because I would have been crazy. Having said that, a little bit of orchestration is always needed. Otherwise, you don't deliver on a short deadline. But I have to say, I really appreciated the diversity and the ability of very intelligent, very diverse people to contribute what they're really expert of, and, you know, withhold the rest.
So, as you know, the Innova Association aims to leverage the talents of people in business to support society. What are the key challenges and opportunities ahead for our country, and how can people from our community contribute?
I would say the challenges coming from COVID are more or less the same everywhere, right? So it's clearly, first of all, the safety of people, and then economic recovery, and then how to absorb the costs of the economic recovery. And so these challenges are the same. I would say in Italy we have a couple of we have a situation which is marginally more difficult. It's more difficult because we have more debt, and it's more difficult because we have an aging population, and more debt, aging population creates a big risk of intergenerational injustice, i.e. using resources in ways which are not good for your generation or for the generation after you, and actually protect essentially our generation and the older part of the country, but not really build for the future. And that's a big risk. I don't think it's a small risk, to be honest. In our work for the prime minister, we have put everything in a medium-term context. And we have recommended, I mean, at the end of the day, we have recommended things which are more or less the same of every other country. So infrastructure, digital environment, social justice. But, you know, in a country which has a lot of debt and an aging population, the risk is that you drift away. And for example, one thing that in Italy is very discussed now is this big role of the state and the fact that the state should intervene in everything. I think the state should intervene, and I'm not against, in principle, state intervention. But you have to be careful that this does not become, duping the country and essentially taking away all incentives to really build a country which is good for 50 years, not for the next for the next five. And so I think people in your organization that tend to be young and tend to have an interest in the long term should really be a little bit more vocal about the long term orientation of the recovery actions. Europe has called the plans Next Generation EU. I think it's a great name because it indicates exactly how we should try to come out of this crisis. I think the youth should speak up more. I'm a bit surprised why in certain countries, especially in Italy, the youth seems to be, young people seem to be a little bit silent on this topic. Spend more in education, spend more in really good infrastructure. It does not mean only physical infrastructure, also social infrastructure, but the good one, the one that is resilient for the long term, the one that can help for example, support young children, have more children, the one that would allow people who are excluded to come back into the workforce, the one that allow people that are not digitally literate to come back, instead of talking only about subsidies. And there is this terrible name that has been invented, Subsidistan. We need to be careful that Italy does not become the land of subsidy and not the land of investment. So your generation should speak up more on how to turn money into good investments and not subsidies, and investment for the future, which does not mean only economic investment, also social investment.
Vittorio, thank you very much for sharing your wisdom with us today. It was very enriching. Thanks again.
Thank you, and God bless you, and best of luck on your lives first, and then your careers. Thank you.